All right. So continuing from our last class's discussion with respect to classification, we were talking about various provisions of the harmonized tariff schedule, various sections, chapters, and other relevant points which do matter for the purposes of customs broker exam and for the purposes of reference classification, being able to navigate through or otherwise use it effectively. So this is basically the main index of the HTSUS. It's online, maintained by the United States International Trade Commission. And as we were going through, we basically look at each section, and we still are looking at various provisions of the HTSUS, and we came down to an attempt to dissect the HTSUS into the two type of understandings, I would say. One is legally binding, and one is for reference purposes only. And of course, I had my reservations about this dissection, but because customs examiners do test on this, this is an important point to cover. Now, with respect to this legally binding stuff, it comes in this little checked place of the harmonized tariff schedule. And if you look at the top, if you start from the top, so this is the way the harmonized tariff schedule, the way it starts, right? And as you scroll down, you will see this little provision called preface. And usually when people get to the HTSUS, they tend to skip preface because who reads preface? Preface is just a mere introduction, blah, 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 something not very important. Not so on the customs broker exam. Let's take a look at the preface. So I click on the preface and I open up to the current version of preface, and they do differ from edition to edition, but the main substance remains the same. So let's take a look at this preface and let's explore it in a little bit more detail. So basically it gives the historical background of the HTSUS. It talks about how it is being codified. It talks about its history. So we have something, a quick discussion, for example, about the international level and the local level, World Customs Organization, that we briefly talked about before. And here comes a little footnote, Who reads the footnotes? Well, in customs broker exam, we read the footnotes. We love the footnotes because footnotes do say important things. In this situation, the footnote number 2 of the preface, harmonized tariff schedule, says that something is legally binding, or the legal text, right, which is legally binding, and something which is not legally binding or non-legal text, all right? So this is where it comes from. And what do they really mean by that? That non-legal versus legal, and which is important for us to really try to get down, is really something is legally binding is something for reference purposes. So if you see a footnote, let's say you have a footnote in one provision. I believe last time we discussed a little footnote in chapter 39, for example. So we go to the chapter 39 of the HTSUS, and the very last, I believe, page has a footnote in it, right? Right there. So we have a footnote right here, footnote 1, says C heading 99022411. And that footnote really refers to what? The footnote refers to here. See the footnote 1. Is that footnote legally binding, meaning that it is a must? No. but it simply gives you the guidance, it simply drives your way through to the right point to check. Why do we need to check that? Because sometimes there is additional provisions associated with Chapter 39, which one we must be aware of, and that might apply to the product. So for example, using the footnote example that we have, Chapter 99 heading 02 may be relevant or may not be relevant, but it's we shouldn't be lazy and we may need to check it. So 99.02, we simply go to the chapter 99 within HTS, which is the last chapter on the list, chapter 99. Temporary legislation, temporary modifications, etc. And we open it up and we simply put in 99.02.2411. So right here, let's see. 99.02.2411. Okay. So, of course, in a real customs broker exam, you would be flipping the pages, but simply because I use the electronic version, I just take shortcuts. So here we go, we found it, right? And what is it, what do we have here? And here we have something interesting. We have an article of plastic, because we were looking at the plastic provision, which says that if you use this number, it could have been duty-free, provided that the product was made out of, or the product itself was bitumen coated shrink wrap polyethylene boots for the protection of the in-ground wood posts. So very specialty product for very specialty industry. As you can see, a little bit of politics going on. So this particular product or this particular lobbying group made sure that this product, which would otherwise be otherwise would be 5.3%, is duty-free just because they were able to lobby this one through, for example. So is this important? Well, even if you weren't lobbying but happened to import those things, this may be relevant. However, let's see, what about the highlighted portion? Why is it highlighted? Well, the highlighting comes from the fact that it is no longer run. Yeah? It's no longer applicable. It expired way back then. Almost before 2009. So that means that it is not applicable. It is exactly, especially not legally binding, and hence we do not claim duty-free provision, but nonetheless there are articles in this chapter which are very much alive, which are very much applicable. So footnotes really direct you to those chapter 99 reference points, so you know what's going on and if special duty may be claimed. All right, any questions on this stuff? All right, so we stopped where? We covered chapter names, section, and I believe we stopped at the section and chapter notes. So looking at the section and chapter notes as HTS components, what do we have? Well, we are left with the following. We are left with section and chapter notes as a components of the HTS, but and those notes they have a huge legal weight. They are part of the general. In fact, they are stated as a must read in a general rule of interpretation one, as we shall see, and we have to check them in order. In order to make sure that the the classification text, the text in the classification tables, is not negated by those section notes or chapter notes, because oftentimes those chapter notes say this chapter does not include, or this section does not include such and such provisions. So important thing to be mindful is each, so we have sections and we have chapters. Chapters. Each chapter, one section covers may cover many chapters, but within the chapter, right, this chapter does not necessarily cover this chapter. So whatever happens in this chapter is solely in its own domain. So here we have HTSUS numbers, for example. Now, going through. The section notes and the chapter notes can be further broken down to the subheading notes and additional US notes. What are these? So let me erase this messy thing for now and just focus a little bit on. So we start with chapter notes, section notes. Very important stuff, must check. Chapter notes, must check, right? And then within the chapter notes, we have subheading notes. Of course, subheading notes are legally binding, but let's look at the significance of what they are. Let me go back to the Harmonized Tariff Schedule of the United States for a second. And talk about them in the context of real stuff that are going on. So let me go back to my favorite chapter of plastics. It can be any chapter, but plastics chapter is really my favorite because we live in a petro age, and I think a lot of provisions here. Really try to catch up with the progress of time. So chapter 39, Articles of Plastics, as you can see, it starts with notes, but notes are general to chapter, and of course you can see, for example, the statement here, this chapter does not cover, and they have a laundry list of things which are not considered articles of plastics. What that means? That means we first of all have to take our heads off and depart from our perceived conceptions of what plastic really means, in as we understand it, and look at the labels, because here to really succeed in this journey, in this customs broker exam journey, you really have to dive yourself in a world of labels. And really, word plastic may mean or may not mean. Is really confined to whatever is stated here. So if you have, for example, lubricating preparations such as oils, they are not considered plastic. You have solutions, you have gums, you have wall coverings, which reagents on the backing of plastics, for example. So what a lab reagent on the backing of plastic? So you have, I don't know, you have a, like a swipe, right? Have some kind of plastic swipe, or you have some plastic dip, you dip it in, and you have some kind of reaction, and you take a look, okay, it turns red, it means bad, it turns white, it means okay, whatever. So it's made out of plastic, but we know, because it says it's, this chapter is not covered, it is not there. So we are really in a world of labels. Now, talking about subheading notes, first of all, let's take a quick recall of what subheading is. Subheading is within the HTSUS number. So HTSUS number is comprised of primarily 10 digits. Those 10 digits have their own names within them. They really have their own level of hierarchy. So just like in a huge family, you have really the dominant members and then less dominant members. So in this 10-digit hierarchy, you have very dominant part and less dominant part. In HTS world, you have dominant part starts at the beginning. So the first two is a very dominant part because first two digits is the chapter name. So you always have 39 associated with chapter 39. The next two, they associate with the heading. Heading is like the big section within a chapter. And then you have next two is a first level subheading followed by another next two second level subheading. So really those digits represent the subheading. A subheading is again another category within a heading.